I'm Scott Hambrick.
I'm Karl Schutt.
And I'm Trent Jones.
And today on the Music and Ideas podcast, we're going to talk about Holst's the planets, or at least some of the planets.
Mm. Yes.
No, I don't know if we're going to talk about all of them. I can't remember.
And dear listener, you know this music. I'm absolutely sure you know this music. Even if you've never heard it, you know it. If you've ever gone to a Star Wars movie, you know it because it's all been stolen.
Yes. Yeah.
I thought you were going to say they know it because it's the form of 20th century classical music.
No, it's the form of 20th century film score.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's, yeah, exactly. It's everywhere. I mean, the whole time I was listening to this, I'm like, oh, that's that movie theme right there. Oh, there's that video game theme. Oh, there's that one. Yeah. I mean, John Williams, this is like the language of John Williams. You said Stravinsky, which, yeah, he definitely borrows heavily from Stravinsky, but yeah, it's also Holst.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so when you
and
listen
every
to
other
this,
film composer,
you'll just be recollecting it.
Right. It's a very strange thing. I've mentioned this before. There's this very odd movie that I'm a little bit fond of from the 80s called Lady Hawk. All right. It's Michelle Pfeiffer and Rutger Hauer. And I think he's a wolf during the night and she's a hawk during the day or something. I don't know. They never meet except like at twilight. And the soundtrack is this Alan Parsons synth soundtrack. And it flopped. Okay. Because for some reason that the weird historical accident that is the symphony orchestra has become the preferred way to do movie soundtracks. You know, all these people mm-hmm. scratching on cat gut with horsehair and blowing into brass tubes has become expressive of every single emotion you could ever want in a film. It's weird when you think about it.
But it makes sense though. I think because it just speaks to the power of the symphony. I mean, you can say and do and evoke whatever you need to. I mean, you know, we talked about the synthesizer a few episodes ago and how it's kind of in theory this machine that can create any timbre you could ever imagine with your mind. But, you know, in practice, really, it's not. It's a fairly limited instrument.
Yeah, here's the problem. All the timbres you should have imagined have already been done.
Right.
Yeah, right. And they're in the symphony. And so I think it just speaks to the power of you can do anything with the symphony. You can be as metal as you want to get. You can be as beautiful and pretty and as pastoral as you want to get and everything in between.
I had to look up Lady Hawk. Lady Hawk, according to Infogalactic, is a 1985 American medieval dark fantasy film directed and produced by Richard Donner and starring Matthew Broderick, Rutger Hauer, and Michelle Pfeiffer. The story mm-hmm. is about a young thief who unwillingly gets involved with a warrior and his lady who are hunted by the Bishop of Aquila? I don't know.
Yeah.
April 12, 1985, budget of $20 million, box office of $18.4 million.
Flop.
That sucks. But that means it's probably pretty good.
It's okay. It has a moment or two.
We watch
movies Michelle where Pfeiffer. Not remakes of everything.
There are no Marvel superheroes named, well, there probably is now, Lady Hawk.
We watched an old documentary from the 80s the other day. My kids and my oldest boyfriend, we all piled up and watched They Live. Hits different. You watched that one?
I don't remember it.
Listen, you got to watch it. Roddy Piper, John Carpenter directed it, and he's got these glasses. He finds these glasses, and he puts them on. He can see everything as it is. It's Plato's cave story is what it is. Hmm. So there's a billboard, you know, and it's got a girl in a bikini on it, and it's advertising for a Caribbean vacation or something. You put your glasses on and look up at it, and it says, obey. You know, so everything's like that, and then there are, of course, like lizard people around. It's really good. But I'll check out Lady Hawk.
Well, I'm gonna have to watch that Carpenter movie.
Oh, it's really great. It's kind of corny, but the premise is awesome, and you know, it's not so novel now.
I find those like horror movies from that era, you know, that didn't have all the crazy special effects. Those are the scariest by far.
Oh, yeah. So we watched all five or six of the Resident Evil movies. My wife and I, we've been rediscovering that you can actually check out DVDs from the library. And you don't have to pay the streaming services and only get the things that they want you to have. And Resident Evil, Mila Jovovich, I don't know.
Meow.
She's good looking. her mother was a Soviet actress, if you look it up. And Resident Evil, the first one it's the perfect zombie film.
That's a big claim.
Because it's pretty good zombie film. It's not zombies scare you. It's like you're stuck in the underground of Raccoon City and you're all going to die and you need to get out. And you don't really see the zombies very much. It's done well, like Trent was talking about. I like it better when you can't see everything. And it was funny, as you get into the middle films, they got into CGI and the films got really bad.
Yeah,
the last one was better because they didn't do it as much. But if you can do everything in a movie, it's like you're doing nothing. You know, if you can have impossible action scenes.
Night of the Living Dead. Have you seen that one?
Yeah. Yes. That one's a little, it's a legend. It was, you know, sort of established a genre, but that one's a little tough for me.
What about it?
I don't know. It's just a little unpolished for me.
Well, yeah, they spent $14 on it or something like that. It's shot in black and white in like 67 or something like that. Have you seen it, Karl?
No.
Oh, you've got to see it. The kids can watch it.
Yeah.
You've got to see it.
Slow zombies.
Yeah. I mean, it's the first real zombie movie. George Romero, is that right?
Romero.
I think it's great.
Yeah, I mean, you know, even if you look at the big budget ones like, you know, The Exorcist, so many of them rely on tension and building a sense of unease rather than straight up jump scares. And they didn't really have the effects, I don't think, to gross you out too much. I mean, they certainly tried, but there's certain movies. We watched The Wicker Man last year, which is a really young Christopher Lee. it's pretty funny, but yeah, it's basically about a couple that go to a rural island in Scotland, I believe. I can't remember which one. And you know, these people are they unwittingly stumble onto this very remote village who is about to start their festival, you know, their pagan festival to celebrate whatever god, and they burn the Wicker Man. And, you know, they need some sacrificial victims. But yeah, I mean, you know, it's just a weird, odd 70s film.
I watched Alien again. Mm. Speaking of tension, the whole movie. You can do a whole lot with atmosphere. I mean, they had hardly any special effects.
Right.
You know, it's a guy, they found a 7-foot Nigerian to put in the alien costume. So he walks weird and, but you don't ever see it full on. You're never quite sure what the thing looks like. Whereas it seems to me, if you made it for the first time now, you would make it all in CGI. You'd get to see everything, but seeing everything makes you not as scared.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
Why is this relevant to, Holst Planets?
Because
I think it is because, yeah, so
well, he's the master of tension.
That was one of the things that stood out to me in this album, you call it? Like, is it a symphony? It's a suite. It's a suite. A suite. One of the things that stood out to me was Holst, I don't know if he invented this, but it's certainly a trope that every film composer borrows, is the ability to create tension with certain musical cues. And we'll listen to the first track here, which you've heard many times if you listen to the OGB podcast. And if you haven't, you should go listen right now. Well, finish this first and then go listen.
The Nietzsche show we just did, Carl, have you listened?
No, I haven't listened. I'm not a fan.
It's fire, man.
slaps.
Yeah.
But when we listen to this first track, Mars, listen to the texture of the strings and how it creates tension and atmosphere and a sense of doom and dread. And what I'm talking about specifically is just kind of like the, I don't know what you call it, but it's, a guitar player would call it tremolo, where you just very quickly like, and you do that very, you know, these short little staccato fast notes, and the strings will just hold a note in the background very quietly. And it creates this, just makes you want to, you need that release, but it doesn't happen.
Yeah. So these are the planets. It's a suite, not a symphony. I don't know what the difference is. I'm not sure I care. Does Karl know? Karl knows all this shit.
Symphony typically has three movements, and the middle is a scherzo. Yeah, this is an extended form. It's not a symphony.
Yeah, this Holst cat, before we kick this off, he was actually, even though his name's Holst, he's an English guy. Let's see here. What was the date on this?
Well, he's 1874 to 1934. He wrote this during World War One. It premiered in 1920, I think. Maybe parts of it premiered in 1918. It's a huge hit. As soon as it came out. He did compose other things. You can't find them.
Right. Yeah.
I played one of his brass band pieces in high school, but this overshadowed by far everything he ever did.
This is called The Planets, but beware. They're not all here. There are only seven of them, because these are about the astrological planets, not the astronomical ones. And I think that's kind of important when you listen to this. And this first piece is Mars, comma, the bringer of war. It ain't just Mars. So let's crank up this thing here. We're going to play from Charles Dutoit. Conducting the Montreal Symphony Orchestra, 1987. Let's go listen here.
Listen to those staccato strings. So we'll come back to that.
I'd rather listen, but it's fine.
Well, we can listen to it again, but point out some things. So the thing that Trent was talking about, what the violins are doing, this is not a tremolo. This is, on my score, I believe it is col legno, which means, I'm not sure what the col means, but what they do, I remember this is way back in 1985, maybe 1984. I was in the high school band room in Chicago Heights, Illinois. Don't dox me. And it was when CDs first had come out. This was new technology. And the band director said, "Karl, come here, listen to this." And he put on The Planets. And he put on Mars. And he turned it up. And you could hear what the violins are doing, what the strings are doing. They take their bows and they flip them over. And they're banging the wood on the string.
Mm.
So it's like percussion.
Yeah, and the strings are kind of elastic, so you can kind of get some bounce if you hit them and let the bow just fall as it will.
Like a drum head.
A YouTube performance of this, there's a pretty good one by the beat by the National Youth Orchestra of England, of Britain. Bunch of kids playing it. And you can see them flip it over and you see exactly what they're doing, how they get the sound. And it was very cool. You know, CDs, to my ear, actually were better than records and cassettes.
Of course.
You could hear more detail. The audiophiles say they can hear stuff. I can't.
There's no way. It's a physical impossibility.
Yeah. Digital is far superior.
Somebody could make an argument that all of the auditory information in the digital recording changes the experience for the worst. I could believe that possibly.
Too much detail.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
But yeah, that's another show.
Yeah.
So it's also, there's a rhythmic oddity that makes you a little bit uncomfortable. Because humans have 2 feet, and so we walk, you know, left, right, left, right, left, right, which you can do 2-4, you can do 4-4. And those would be more natural. This is 5-4. It's got an extra step. It's like you're limping. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's already, speaking of tension, right there. Normal 4-4 time doesn't create tension. For some reason, waltzes don't create tension either. Let me tell you a secret. I think a waltz is actually, it's either in 2-4 or 4-4 time. It's just each beat has 3 subbeats.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, we talked about that. Well, that's kind of, I think, to our Western ear, the feeling of 3 that you get in a waltz, the da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, is, you know, it's superimposed over a 4 beat or 2 beat. So that is kind of like all of our music in the Western world is rooted in that. So if you introduce a true odd time signature like 5-4, it's very counter to our instinct of what music should do.
Yeah, you're listening to this, what the heck's going on? And then we get the bassoons coming in and the horns, and we get, if you listened to our heavy metal podcast, which you should go back and listen to that one. It's the tritone. The tritone, in this case, from G to D flat, which is the second most dissonant interval you can have. That's the most dissonant. This is the second most. And it sounds evil. It's like a kid, you know, because I did this, okay? So I learn about dissonance when I'm a high school kid and I would spend my lunches sitting at the piano. I didn't get piano lessons. I didn't like other people very much, so I would just go play the piano in the band room. And you find out, and I would say, I'm going to play around with this. And then I might say, what can I do? And there you have the planets. You know, it's like a kid sitting and playing and making, what's the most evil sound I can make?
So what you're saying is you wrote the planets in 84 in the band room at lunch hour?
No, I rewrote it. It's the sort of thing that a musically precocious kid would do if he wants to make evil sounds.
Why are they evil?
Because they don't resolve. I mean, they're fighting. The waveforms don't match nicely. Could get into the physics of it, but...
Yeah, I think the notes are actually battling each other for your attention. They don't fit nicely into a major chord or a nice major triad or whatever. The frequencies are literally battling each other for your aural attention.
They're beating.
Yeah, beating. And so that kind of matches nicely with our war theme here. You need a tritone because we're about to clash.
Yeah. This is the sound of World War I, you know? What in the hell happened to us? World War I.
Technology got ahead of tactics.
Is that what happened in World War II? Because more people died in World War II.
Yeah, I don't know. Mechanization of the destruction of everybody else. It's
productivity, man.
It was very productive.
Very productive.
It's like Henry Ford goes to war.
There's our we need a treatment for this. We're going to go pitch this movie, Henry Ford Goes to War.
Well, so I in online great books, my group, I kind of rolled back because I took a few months off, but we just finished Herodotus, which is about the Greco-Persian War. And I don't know, maybe it's just because I've watched too many movies, but there's something, dare I say, virtuous about hand-to-hand combat. And it's not to say they didn't have technology, because they did. You know, they rammed each other with triremes, and they had you know, spears and shields and different types of armor, and that played into why the Greeks won. But yeah, I don't know. There's something about, well, if we look at it from a Homeric standpoint, you know, this sort of, you know, one-on-one, 1v1 combat, there's a chance to win glory there. Whereas if you just mow down a bunch of guys with a machine gun from a bunker, I don't know.
It makes the aggressor pay a bigger price if he has to do it. The victor. Yeah. It makes the victor pay a bigger price than when it's hand-to-hand than when it's drone strikes.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a...
And by the way, can you have a victory with drone strikes? I think that history will tell us no.
If you... there's a poem by Auden. And there's a whole bunch of good English poems from about this time. The Shield of Achilles. And it's about the mechanization. It's about the industrialization of war. There isn't any glory in it anymore.
Yeah.
Except there's glory in this music. I don't know, but it's like the thing, it's coming along. It's like this machine that has a gear that's got a five, you know, it's like a five-tuple gear, and it's just motoring on towards you. And
I actually had that thought in my head when I, you know, the scenes that just get conjured up by this music was a tank. You know, it's like the rattling of the tracks over the ground. You know, it's kind of it's circular in a sense, but not exactly circular. It's imperfect, and there's, you know.
Oh, you know what this reminds me of? I don't know if you'll be able to find it, but the theme to the first Terminator movie by Brad Fidel. Fidel? It's like, I think the meter is 13.6, except it's not quite. It's like 13.25 6. He just looped all these sounds that he was making in his kitchen, banging on pipes and stuff. Doesn't this sound like Mars?
Yeah.
And there's the mechanized soldier coming at you, who's entirely machine.
Yeah.
I used to deadlift to this.
Good choice.
Well, because I had to be a machine, because I hate the deadlift so much. I have to just be a cyborg whose only purpose is to deadlift.
So you said, so doesn't this sound like Mars? And yeah, I mean, it's reminiscent of Mars. You know, I'm always interested in that question. Does it sound like, well, what does that actually mean? Because it's not in the same key. The instruments aren't the same, you know, whatever. But do you think the guy listened? I mean, Mars is huge. It's the gateway drug for classical music for so many of us. You know, it's so popular. It was hit when he quote unquote released it. You know, when it debuted. So there's not much chance that the composer of the Terminator theme had not heard it. But do you think that he said, "I'm going to make some Mars-like stuff for this sci-fi movie," or do you think that if this is some platonic stuff, Karl? Do you think that if one is going to write a theme for a violent movie that is going to be tense and evocative of the themes in the movie, that this is what you get?
Yeah. I think, well, certainly after Holst, it's what you get. That's my big question. You know, we have this establishment of the symphony and the sorts of tropes of film score music that we have. Did it have to be this way? Are we expressing reality? Or is it a historical accident that Holst does it this way and now everybody else does it this way?
I don't want to minimize Holst's work, because you guys know I love it. I mean, we kicked off the Online Great Books podcast, and I thought, what am I going to use for bumper music? And there was no second choice at all. I love it. It's one of the first CDs I bought. I have the score somewhere that I've written on. I've listened to this and looked at the score 100 times. It's probably the piece that I kind of learned to read scores with, you know, when I was, I don't know, 12. Take that, Karl, you nerd. So I don't want to minimize what Holst is doing here, but I mean, this is what conflict sounds like. I think there's something about the psychology of the human that identifies this as the sound of conflict, and he tapped into that perfectly. So anytime anybody else does it, this is my theory, anytime anybody else does that, we're to say, well, that sounds like Holst. Well, no, it sounds like conflict.
Well, it's like saying, if there's a beautiful woman and you say, well, you know, so-and-so, she looks like Grace Kelly.
Right.
I guess, but the problem is both of them look like beauty.
Karl and Grace Kelly. So, Katie King, she said one time she wanted to do a contest where if somebody counted, could tell us exactly how many times Karl mentions Grace Kelly in a podcast, or I say distinctly American in a podcast, that she would give like a free t-shirt.
I'm feeling attacked here.
I want to bring it back to Herodotus for a second, and then let's listen to some more. So one of the things that struck me about reading about the conflict of the Greeks and the Persians is that the Greeks can't get along ever. They're just constantly bickering and arguing with each other, especially Athens and Sparta. But when the chips were down and their backs were against the wall, they managed to pull together an army and defeat this massive land invasion and a massive sea invasion. And so in that moment of the conflict, right, you have to have, to your point, Scott, you have to have, like, the mindset becomes very black and white, I think, in that there has to be a clear enemy and you have to have a clear motive for what you're doing. If you don't, then it becomes very difficult to rally people to your cause. And this is what we see with the Greeks. Like, it did not go well until they finally all, like, somebody, you know, by reason or by rhetoric or by trickery, gets a bunch of people together on the field lined up against the Persians, like, here we go. And then all of a sudden, there's a different focus in the minds of men and the collective. And that's, to me, like the sound of conflict.
So
is it becomes very stark.
I want to do an experiment. So just point out a few more things, and I want to listen to the first minute 30 again. Because what Trent's talking about, I mean, Aristotle talks about this when, you know, if there are forms, how do you get universals? And he says, well, this is in Posterior Analytics 219, I think, where an army that is being routed are fleeing. But then suddenly one of them turns around and then another one turns around. And then at some point they become a formation and are fighting, and it's a good thing. And this is supposed to be how a number of impressions become a universal in your mind. So if you listen to this, the rising tension, there's some cool things to note. Like, I wanted to point out the muted trumpets at about 30 seconds in, you'll hear it, which is also a tension builder. You stick this mute, sometimes it's made of wood, sometimes it's made of metal, in the end of the horn. It makes it more sawtoothy. Do they count up the times I say sawtooth?
Sawtooth wave.
Yeah. So you'll hear that. But then right around 52 seconds in, there's a change in the flavor. And so it's no longer, it's like, it becomes, it's not the tritone anymore. It's fourths and fifth. And it becomes, for a moment, really kind of glorious.
Yes.
And it's very cool how he does this. He hasn't changed any of the substance. There's still that da-da-da-dun-dun-dun-dun going on. But just changing a half step in some of the things, and it becomes consonant and cool as we go up to probably minute 30.
Shall we kick it off again?
Okay.
oboe.
Where's that muted trumpet?
And now the change.
It's like the tide of battle changing, like overwinning, winning. Reinforcements arrived.
So when you listen to this, we can go on further. The problem is I don't want to, it's like 8 minutes long. I don't want to stop it ever.
right.
But it's, there's these moments in there where the light shines in. And so it's mostly dissonant, but then occasionally, you know, it's not. And so there's tension and then there's release. So it's like, if you're thinking that this is a statement about war, I don't know if it is. It's astrology. Mars is, I couldn't bear to look up all the astrology stuff. I was thinking if I'd known Gustav Holst, I probably wouldn't have liked him very much. Because he'd come and he'd say, well, have you had your horoscope done? And I'd say, no, I'm not really into that. And he's directing the Hammersmith or whatever it is, the socialist choir. He met his wife in the socialist choir. Right. All right, Gustav. But then I would hear the music and I would say, you know what, Gustav, you're all right.
Do you think he charged crystals in the window during a full moon?
Yeah, I think so. But so it's probably, you know, they had dream catchers and everything. It's probably about astrology. And so Mars is a bringer of conflict, but conflict is not necessarily a bad thing in the tendencies, I suppose, in astrology. You know, you're never going to get the girl if you don't have some Mars in you. But if you were going to read this as being about war, well, everybody hates war except that they don't. You know, if humans actually hated war, we wouldn't fight them so often.
Yeah, that's one of the big themes or questions or problems that comes up in seminar over the Iliad is that, you know, the Iliad is a gory book, but it's also about glory. And, you know, the thing's a Rorschach test. You know, people read that and some people think it glorifies war and makes war attractive, and other people think it makes it look awful. And a lot of conflict in seminars are between the sort of two kinds of people that see those two different stories there in that same book. So is this to make war more glorious, this piece here, or does it make it more awful?
Or there's a third possibility, which is true.
There are only two.
Nope.
Oh.
There's two kinds of people in the world, the kind that divide everything into groups of two people and the kind that don't. The third possibility is it is an expression of the truth of war, like the Iliad is. And right. So it's awful and it's glorious.
Mm-hmm. Musically, I think it's so interesting, like how this is happening. And once you hear this in Holst, like I said, you'll hear it in all the film composers, but Karl, you pointed out the tritone, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, then you have this, you said there's all these fourths and fifths that come in the melody. And I don't know I haven't looked at the score for this particular piece, but it's interesting. A very, very common mode that film composers will play in is Lydian. And that the key to that is there's a raised fourth. And this is the glory part to me. So if I play just a C major scale, that's just with a normal, you know, there's my one and four. The Lydian key has a raised fourth. So we're going to sharp the four. So we're going to take that from an F to an F sharp. So now it's Okay. And I think that that act of raising the four creates this sort of reaching upwards, this triumphant sort of sound. And it makes more sense when you kind of put it in the context of chords. Like, there's a just basic, you know, 1/5 octave C, and then I'm going to add the sharp four. All of a sudden, it changes to something that is more celestial. It's sort of more open. To me, it sort of reaches a little higher, and it is higher. It's the act of raising the fourth note up by a semitone. And once you hear this, it's everywhere. You know, if you do it with sustained strings. I mean, there you go. That's just adding, that's just Lydian mode. There's some other ones too, Mixolydian, but that it's the use of that particular trick with the harmonies that creates this, I think what you're talking about, Karl, that it allows you to move between moods and modes easily.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's cool that it gets happy almost. And then it moves between the two things. I mean, look, Call of Duty would not be as popular of a game as it is if people didn't like war. You can't just have it all be bad. It makes a lousy, it would be, if you're making a war movie and it's all, this is how bad war is, it's not a good war movie. Or if you made one that was, this is how great it is, it would not be a good war movie. Say, you should rather say, this is what it is. And it's going to be kind of like this movement of this suite, where sometimes it's terrifying and sometimes it's the light shines in and it's glorious. I'm using that word too much.
I don't know. I don't know if you're using it too much. Yeah, it's about definitive action, you know, like maybe, you know, in war, you have license to act in way where in this world that is now fake and strange, we don't necessarily feel, you know, that sort of executive, you know, freedom to act like that. And then, you know, you watch, if you play Battlefield 1, you know, you can problem solve, let's say, in ways that you can't when the HR lady is watching.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's listen to some more Holsts. We're still on number one, Mars, the Ringer of War. This is at a minute 40. Try to lay some breadcrumbs down for poor Trent when he goes to piece this back together. I've always thought this sounded like a storm at sea, this one is here.
It's like a dance. It's weird. Tricky little trumpet first. Yeah.
This is very Gershwin-like right through here. Oh, it's over.
Oh, not quite, but hold on. Pause right there. Okay. So There's cool things to talk about that kind of rollicking dun 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 dun. It's suddenly there's a dance going on. That's strange to me if it's going to be bringer of war and how horrible war is.
But Mars is having influence on Venus, and your horoscope's all fucked up, and you know.
Right.
The celestial dance, Karl.
Now, what I want you to do is pull up. I have a link for you, Scott.
What is it?
If I can, it's the first track from A New Hope.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah.
And you go to around minute 130.
On Spotify. Do we like Spotify? wait a minute. I ask that, and then Spotify just let me know that I don't. Look at this shit. Look at this. You see the little lightsaber here?
Yeah. Yeah.
You see that?
When you play Star Wars, you get the lightsaber. I noticed that a couple of days ago when I was referencing some tracks.
Yeah, so at the bottom of the screen, you know, on Spotify, listener, you get the little cursor that moves from left to right, you know, for 1 second, 2 seconds, 5 minutes, you know, through the track. Well, here it's a lightsaber.
And they got the color wrong for this movie. They have the green lightsaber, but this is A New Hope.
Nerd.
There's a blue lightsaber at this point.
A minute 30, is that where we're going, Carl?
Yeah, roughly. All right. Now pause that. Okay. Go back to 3 minutes and 1 second in Mars. It's in the same key. He didn't even change the key.
So what you're saying is John Williams is the Dr. Dre of this shit? He's just sampling?
He's sampling it. I didn't have this as a wave theme. I had it as a weeping theme.
Mm.
See, I see the like the lines of battle moving back and forth. It's kind of like a wave, I guess. Or storm.
You know, Carl and I did a podcast with Thomas Mieris, and I can't remember which one it is, like about the Fritz Lang movie Metropolis, which is, this is 1918, Carl?
The music?
The planets, yeah.
Yeah.
And Metropolis is Weimar Republic, 1927. Movie, I think, something
close,
like that.
Yeah.
And melodramatic. The acting in silent movies has become something that we make fun of, you know? Everything's over the top. Yeah, it's melodramatic. Yeah, it is a 1927 movie. But I think that this piece is melodramatic in the same way that acting in those silent films is. I mean, he pulls no punches. He leaves nothing behind to make whatever effect land that he wants to land. There's nothing subtle about this thing ever.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, I like my sledgehammers in my classical music, and he delivers.
But supposedly, early work influenced by Wagner. Well, that's the thing. Wagner, if there's a place that he can go, he's damn well going to go there.
Right.
You know, if four trombones are good, but eight trombones would be better, there's going to be 12.
Yeah.
Why not?
I mean, it's metal, you know? I could do this and be understated and let the audience fill in the gaps. To hell with that. I'm going to hit them over the head with a sledgehammer and make them feel what I want them to feel.
Well, yeah.
What would Beethoven say about this?
What would Beethoven say? If he could hear it. I was thinking about Beethoven in this, and I love this piece. I don't love it as well as I love Beethoven.
Agreed. Now why? I'm baiting you out.
Well, what I was trying to figure out why, because this is my impression. I think for Holst, what you have are a bunch of cool themes. There's maybe five of them in Mars that he just stitches, to my mind, he stitches together and he orchestrates really well, but he doesn't really develop. So, you know, you have dun 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 da 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 da, you have that one, you have the da 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 da, you know, and you have the first one, the I don't think he works out where you could go with all of these themes by developing them. He puts them in order and then he shuffles them and he brings them back. Whereas in Fifth Symphony, you get every single possible permutation of that in that symphony.
Yeah, I was immediately reminded of the third movement when it comes in with those big horns. Dun, 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 da, da, dun, dun.
Yeah.
It's in here. It's in here, too. I think the difference is, I would characterize it a little differently. I agree with you, Karl, but I would characterize it as Beethoven writes themes which can be expounded upon. Holst's themes, I mean, they just are what they are. I don't think there's anywhere else to go than what he's already given you. It would take away, if you added anything else, you tried to sort of evolve these Mars themes further, you would kind of lose the point of the piece, in my mind. Like, there's not really anywhere else to go. Whereas with Beethoven, I don't know what it is. It's an ineffable quality. But his melodies can lead you so many places, whereas Holst is a little bit more black and white, I guess, for lack of a better term.
Maybe it's more like a picture rather than a conversation. You know, here's Mars, here's war. This is what it looks like. And for Beethoven, he's talking to you, you know.
Yeah.
Here's my thought, da-da-da-dum. But I have another thought, da-da-da-dum. And then I'm going to do the whole conversation down to, you know, that last movement.
Yeah.
Me being super sour like I have been for the last 2 weeks. Like, I started out sour, and it's gotten worse over the last 14 days, guys.
I'm sorry.
The reason for me, I mean, everything that you guys said is true, I think, about Beethoven versus Holst. And yes, and I think that this Holst piece just is modern. It's like the anti-hero in the Breaking Bad series or something like that. You know, like, there's something about modern fiction, modern writing, where it shies away from just nobility, right? You have to see the seamy underbelly. You have to see the fault in the character. It has to be Tony Soprano. It has to be Heisenberg, whatever. And in Beethoven is fine just feeding you on a steady diet of pure beauty and nobility. And this doesn't have that hope in it that I hear in Beethoven.
Well, not this one.
Well.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's, I agree with you. That's my big problem with modernity.
You know, everything I'm saying here is completely made up and completely my opinion. I don't have a mind meld with Beethoven. But it seems like, having listened to as much of it as I've listened to, that if Beethoven was challenged to write Mars, the Bringer of War, and we had a battle of the composers, he would give us a glimpse of the good that came from the peace and from the death.
Oh, sure. Well, you can see that the example, you know, he's dying and he's deaf and he's sick and he's writing the most optimistic piece of music ever, which is Ninth Symphony, which he never heard. But the Ode to Joy, I mean, Holst has apparently had a problem with people ending it. People would rearrange the planets and they would end it with Jupiter because Jupiter is fun and happy.
Mm. Yeah.
As a happy ending, and he says he didn't like that because he didn't think there were happy endings.
Are you sure this guy was English? Sounds pretty German to me.
Yeah. Well, right. Well, you know.
Do we want to move on to...
Do we want to hear the Bringer of Peace, or do we want to hear Jollity?
Yeah, I kind of want to skip over to Jupiter. Of all the tracks, Venus is the one that I just couldn't give you much for. It's 9 minutes and 38 seconds of very quiet, lilting.
Oh, it's so pretty, though.
Yeah, see,
it's kind of pastoral, but I'd rather listen to Beethoven 6 if I want that.
See, kind of piece is kind of boring, huh?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
I want explosions and...
See, this is your modern mystery. Problem. You can't just sit and wait.
Right.
All right. Okay. Except, I want you to start, because we've got to give people the ending here. We can't just leave them off. Okay. Start, yeah. I don't know, around 5:45 or so.
7 minutes.
Let's let him end this thing, and you'll hear that Star Wars even more. Right here. Yeah, okay. Think it's going to be a quiet resolution, but just wait. The Star Destroyer shows up again.
Good.
That's good. If you had to guess what instrument Gustav played in the orchestra, what would you guess?
Either timpani or tuba.
I was going to say timpani too. Yeah.
Turns out he was a trombonist.
Mm.
Man, he loves those deep brass instruments.
Yeah, the brass writing's pretty good. It's a brass so player. Good. it's fun to play.
Everything
we always want to play loud. You know, if you're ever going to play in an orchestra and if you're a trumpet player and you're playing in an orchestra, you're pretty much just counting lots of measures of rest and then playing a fanfare when it's been long enough that you're completely unwarmed up and you have to play like pop out a high note and then you go back and play cards. It's super boring. Not in Holst. You have to be awake the whole time.
Yeah, and it's forte to triple forte the whole time. That's the range of dynamics you play as a brass player.
Well, except in Venus, but you don't want to play Venus, so fine.
Yeah, you just set that one out. As a side note, I wanted to kind of do something sometime I think would be kind of fun, is what is the best first trumpet theme out there? So... You know, first trumpet plays all the high notes. That's their specialty. And so when it comes to if we're talking Star Wars or Jurassic Park or whatever, that's the guy that gets to blast all the really super loud high notes.
Hmm.
It'd be fun to go through a whole bunch of them and see if we can pick a winner.
Although technically, actually, trombone's louder. It's the loudest instrument in the orchestra.
Yeah, yeah.
Trombones. Not a lot of bends in that tubing. Number four, Jupiter, the bringer of jollity. Here, I'm going to hit stop. So you hit play on these classical pieces. This isn't classical, actually. But whatever. You hit play, and there's silence before you actually hear the music, you know, and you watch the counter. You're like, did I hit play? And you watch the counter. It goes 1, 2, 3. Well, if you've ever been in an orchestra or whatever, you know that the conductor is like telling, you know, Susan, like the fourth clarinetist, like, listen, if you come in early, it's over for you, you know. No, you know, and he's going over like the little things that he knows that could be rough and kind of giving a little bit of a pep talk. So he, you know, before he gives the downbeat. So whenever I hit play and I see that 3 seconds of silence come by, I'm like, what was Dutoit telling, you know, the D student out there, you know? Sounds like the intro to the nightly news.
See, that's Zelda right there.
Oh,
Kokiri Forest or the Lost Woods.
That's funny.
All right, let's pause and chat a little bit.
Aaron Copland, that crook.
So the music's very, you heard Scott saying some things that he thought it was expressing. It's very evocative. It's hard not to have pictures in your mind of these things. So, I mean, you go to the concert and Jupiter, the bringer of jollity. And that's all you know about it. And then it starts. And then you're thinking in those terms. Jupiter is, I guess in astrology and for the Romans, Jupiter is not quite the same as Zeus. Zeus is kind of scary, but Jupiter's kind of jolly.
Is he like the Zeus in the movie Hercules? This big, jacked, bearded guy that's just like always smiling and laughing and smiting.
You mean Hercules Goes Bananas, the Arnold Schwarzenegger film?
Oh, no. I was talking
about the Disney
one. Yeah, yeah.
but there's cool things. If you look at the very beginning, the violins, to me, it's like a guitar with a delay. So you have, I'm sure I can play it. And so they're playing something like that, and some of them are playing up here. But they're starting at different parts of the measure. So the first violins are playing it, you know, right on one. The second violins are playing it like offset. So it kind of shimmers, and it's like you were playing, it's like you're the Edge from U2.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Something kind of like that.
That's what it is, but he's doing it without any effects. And I'm thinking, da-da-da-da-da-da, I'm thinking, you know, that's like everybody saying, ooh, there's a party. Let's go to the party.
Can I interrupt?
Yeah.
I just did. Can we do a show where I shit on U2 for 2 hours?
Oh, yeah. I got a new phone and recently.
Had that Red album on it?
Yes.
Oh, my God. They're so bad.
Oh, my God. Still, that was like 12 years ago when they forced their garbage album to autoplay every time you plug in the headphones. And I got this new phone, and it still have that problem. That's just unconscionable.
I like early U2. I like them up through Joshua Tree and maybe one album after that. I'm sorry. But they were good when they weren't good. And then when they got good, they got bad. If that makes any sense.
You've heard the joke about Stevie Ray Vaughan dying and going to heaven. And he's like, oh my gosh, it's Beethoven. And he walks around some more. Oh my gosh, it's Jimi Hendrix. You know, St. Peter's with him. He says, oh my gosh, it's Bono. He's like, no, that's God. He just thinks he's Bono. I never understood the whole U2 thing. I've got a good friend. He's seen him in concert so many times. I'm like, I don't want it. Why? I don't understand. All right, back to Holst. Don't understand.
So, well, I don't know. I'm thinking in pictures. The part where we ended, dun, 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 dun. For me, that's like the party host shows up. You know, the Jupiter has strolled in. And he's got this rolling gait, and he's happy. He's greeting everybody. How are you doing? Welcome to my party.
It's a montage, you know. It's like if you're doing the movie, and this is where the camera's panning through Hogwarts, and you're seeing all the students you're doing their activities and riding broomsticks over here, and like you know getting eaten by a monstrous plant over there, and you know this is what you play, dum 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 dum, while the camera sweeps through the grounds of the you know the idyllic schoolhouse.
So much has been taken
yes,
from
and
us.
Speaking of Hogwarts, by the way, the movements that we did not do. A bit of it in Venus and some of it in Mercury when the Celeste is playing.
Yes.
You know, that's from Holst.
Yeah. Yeah. You know.
Yeah. A Celeste is a piano that has chimes inside of it. I can't make the sound right here, but you hear it in the Harry Potter stuff. So it's, you play it like a piano, but it's like hitting the chimes with hammers.
Play it on your hurdy-gurdy.
I don't have a hurdy-gurdy.
Or your ocarina.
Ollie's. Sorry. No, I have an ocarina, but it's... You
know, of course it's, you do. Let's play a little more of Jupiter here. Oh, wait a minute. No, I remember what I was going to say. We all keep comparing it, and you guys more than me, to these scenes from these movies. And there's nothing wrong with that, but imagine... Like at one point we listened to like radio shows, you know, there was no television and you had no idea what Johnny Dollar looked like, you know, and he looked like a detective is supposed to look like in your mind. And you listen to the Johnny Dollar radio show or the Lone Ranger or whatever, Fibber McGee and Molly. What if you could listen to this and you hadn't seen all these rubbish movies and you could just... Let it hit you as it's supposed to, you know?
It would be a privilege to be able to do that.
Yeah. Wouldn't it?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. My thought after listening to the whole suite the first time was, if you're a writer or a painter or a creative of any kind, just go into a room where it's quiet, turn the lights down, and listen to this. It's 52 minutes, not that long. Listen to the whole thing. Like, how can you not have an idea after listening to this? Mm-hmm. I mean, it just paints pictures for you. Yeah, you don't have to have all these modern movie references. It does the job for you. Like, this is just instant, you know, shot of creativity.
Yeah, it's so powerful. And I think this is impressionistic. You know, so we've got Van Gogh. He's an impressionist. You know, this is kind of late for impressionism. But, you know, he's painting with broad strokes here to give us a vibe, and he's not as interested in like intellectually, you know, extra, you know, explication of the whole theme like maybe Beethoven would be. You know, he's going to get in there for 8 minutes and hit you on the head with Jupiter, and then we're going to move on. And I don't know. It's just an interesting time there. Rosvicky was doing this, and Stravinsky did it a little bit later, and that makes this music really accessible and fun, but it's also a little more shallow than the Beethoven. But you know, I wish I could hear it clean. You know, the first time I heard it, I had already seen Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and you know, and other stuff, and it kind of stinks.
I want to read a quote that I got from it's on Infogalactic's Holst page. So he was, you know, early English socialist and fine, hanging out with George Bernard Shaw and okay. And so there's this movement to have art for everybody. And in a sense, that's what this is, but it's really accessible. But I like Holst's quote here. Aristocracy and art. Art is not for all, but only for the chosen few. But the only way to find those few is to bring art to everyone. Then the artists have a sort of Masonic signal by which they recognize each other in the crowd. So, this music is very accessible. It's loud. It's got cool stuff in it. Who's going to hate it? You know, 90% of the people that hear the planets are going to like it. 2% of them are going to really like it and are going to, you know, maybe be drawn to the higher bits of music from it.
Yeah.
I just like that idea. I mean, that's like, I mean, Nietzsche said this in that thing that we read on education a long, long time ago. You know, universal education isn't for the sake of everybody becoming universally educated, because they can't. You do it so that you catch the high risers.
Something just came to mind, a bit tangential, but the role of economics in how this music develops later on in movie scores. You know, when you hire John Williams, maybe not the first time he got hired, but certainly after he came out with the Star Wars, the first Star Wars soundtrack. When you hire John Williams, why do you hire that guy? Like, you hire him because you know you're going to sell a bunch of CDs of the original soundtrack, and you know he's not going to screw up the movie. Like, you know exactly what you're going to get. And if you're going to spend $100 million on a movie, like, you go with the safe bet. Like, you go with a guaranteed ROI with the creative input that you're going to put in there. Same thing with Hans Zimmer, right? Like, it's not going to be spectacular, in my opinion, but it's not going to suck either. It's going to work. And that's kind of what this, like, democratization of music gets to ultimately, is it's really great. It's a really great commercial tool when you're talking about making commercial art. It's like the consultant that buys IBM computers, because if they suck, you're like, well, but I bought IBM. They're the best.
That's why you buy Rogue, by the way.
Can't get fired for that.
Nobody gets fired for buying Rogue.
Yeah, right? Well, yeah, and there's something about that.
This is very interesting to me. I was thinking about movie stars the other day. You're right about Williams. Like, what does it cost to hire Williams? I have no idea. A tenth of what it costs to hire Brad Pitt or Johnny Depp or somebody like that. A hundredth. Like, do you think John Williams gets $10 million for a score? I doubt it.
Probably not.
A million?
Probably not.
Maybe.
Sure.
Maybe.
Yeah. For him, yeah. But, you know, he's the top of the heap, too.
Right. Danny Elfman gets $850,000. You know, I don't know. But,
yeah.
But, like, some of these guys that get all this money, these actors, they're really not bringing anything to the table. I'm sorry. Johnny Depp, like, is there not another, like, middle-aged, nice-looking guy that can swagger a little bit for a tenth of the cost? Yeah. Like, does Johnny Depp actually sell movies? How about that bowel movement, M. Night Shyamalan, whatever?
Shyamalan?
Like, yeah, they keep paying this guy to make these flops. Like, pay him huge dollars. Like, what is going on? Is it money laundering? Like, what are they doing?
Well, apparently his movies sell really well overseas. So they give him, like, $5 million to go make a movie, which is not very much, and he makes $20 million overseas or whatever.
Blech.
And they suck in the U.S.
They suck everywhere. But they suck buy them in India. It's fine. Yeah. Whatever, you know?
Yeah, sure.
They suck.
What was
everywhere.
His big movie?
Oh, Lord have mercy.
God. Sixth
Sense, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This Signs, The Village.
Signs is all right. Sixth Sense I figured out within 5 minutes.
The Last Airbender.
And I leaned over to Melissa and I said, he's already dead.
Right.
Weren't.
But like, why does Tom Cruise get that money?
Well, okay. So let me venture a guess. I actually had this exact conversation in the car with Jordan when we were driving out to the Smoky Mountains about Brad Pitt, not Tom Cruise. But because we're like, well, you know, the thing about Brad Pitt is that, like, is he the best actor? No. What is the best actor? He's not the best actor for every type of movie that he does. That's for sure. But he's pretty good. And I think that's the key, is that Brad Pitt can be funny enough when you need him to, when he's in Inglourious Basterds. And he can be serious enough. He can be heroic enough. And he makes you feel like no one else could have played that role. Whether it's true or not, I'm sure plenty of actors could have played that role too, but he makes you feel like he was the only choice for the part.
The thing about Brad Pitt, for all of you that came to listen to the show about Holst, tough. The thing about Brad Pitt, I put in a different category. I think Brad Pitt can pick movies.
Yeah, that's a big part of it.
Brad Pitt picks weird, weird movies that he agrees to be in. And there's something about, like, I'm not a big movie guy, but if Brad Pitt chooses to be in a movie, I probably need to watch it. He gets pitched every movie at this point.
Yeah.
Oh, we wrote this with you in mind, Brad. You have a look. You know. But if he's like, I'm going to be in Snatch. Like, I need to go look at that. And Snatch is awesome.
Yeah.
Brad Pitt picks the movies. Tom Cruise, his picker is no good. Mission Impossible, whatever. Beat it. You know? But so Brad Pitt, I put him in a little bit different category.
Sure. Yeah.
Tom Cruise was very good in Tropic Thunder.
Never saw it.
That's a must.
Yeah, but why are these people getting this money? This huge money to be in these movies. Like, whoever, pick a guy that's played Captain America. What? Like, there's a guy at your gym right now that could have played that for, you know, would gladly have done that 6 months of work with, like, the Kraft's food service for, I don't know, $85,000.
Yeah. Yeah.
You've got to pay Hemsworth what? Really?
Movies are weird. Movies are a weird thing.
It's got to be money laundering, man. It's got to be.
There's definitely tax sheltering, money laundering, all the above.
Like, seriously, there's a square-headed, good-looking dude at your gym right now that could play the next Marvel superhero.
Yeah. You need some chest, biceps, some traps. That's all you need.
Right.
You don't need
follows
legs.
Instructions, doesn't mess up too bad.
Yeah, right.
But it's Hemsworth, huh? That's what it's going to be? Christian Bale, let's see it, right? No. I don't understand it.
Yeah, it's so weird. Well, I mean, you know, without going too far off track, if you ever look into the accounting that's done for movies, it's insane. You know, they'll gross $1 billion, and they're like, we didn't turn a profit.
Right.
We're in the red. It's like, come on.
Did you ever see The Producers?
Yeah.
Mel Brooks film?
Yeah.
Their plan is to fund to fund a show, okay? Zero Mostel's in it, and Gene Hackman.
The other Gene, the curly-haired Gene.
Yeah. Gene Simmons.
Yeah.
Not Gene Simmons. The guy that played Willy Wonka.
Yeah, Willy Wonka.
Gene Wilder.
I'm sorry.
There you go. Yeah.
I'm sorry. And they come up with a plan. They're going to get subscribers for this play that they're going to put on, and they want it to be a flop, and then they're going to take the money and run. And the problem is that it becomes a hit. So, I mean, they hire some Nazis living on a roof in New York City, and they get him to, they option his script, Springtime for Hitler. and they make it into a musical, and they get a very flamboyant director, and it's over the top, and it becomes a huge hit, and then comic hijinks happen. I think that might be the movie industry.
Yeah, they can force one through. They can force a bowel movement through. There's no, I mean, Star Wars.
Yeah.
All the Star Wars movies.
I like the first one, but I'm kind of mad that I liked it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to go back to...
Yeah, anyway.
Should we talk music a little more? I want to talk about John Williams. So John Williams, as much of a thief as he is, I wouldn't have listened to Beethoven if I hadn't got those LPs of Star Wars when I was a kid.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of John Williams. I don't want anybody to think I'm being negative about him.
Right.
You're always going to enjoy what he does. You're just going to say, well, that's this composer, you know? But the reason I read that quote, so this is a very accessible piece of music, just like John Williams is, and it's a really good place to start in classical music. Mm-hmm. I hope you go further. There's a lot more out there than this, but this will get you in the door.
Yeah, go listen to this. Go listen to the Mussorgsky. Go listen to Copeland. Karl's beloved Resvigi. all those will really help you wade into the deep end without drowning. Without drowning early. You'll drown later.
Yeah.
but just fine. But you want to hear some more Jupiter?
Yeah, let's let it roll. There's so many good themes in here.
tempo speeding up.
I was thinking they were setting up the buffet table.
Yeah, the wine is flowing now.
And this is when the host says, I'm going to say a few words.
And again, listen to those strings very quietly. That sort of tremolo movement. I can't help myself. This is the theme to Morrowind. This is the Elder Scrolls theme. Like, almost note for note. So close.
It's the most English-sounding part of the whole thing.
Sounds to me like a Teuton doing an English impersonation.
Top of the hill.
Beautiful.
Sunlight in the background.
That is the coolest part of, that's just such a very cool melody. I say it sounds English to me.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds, if you are a high church Anglican, you may have heard that in your church. It's actually a hymn. It's been made into a hymn. I linked something on our Slack channel of some chorus in England singing it for a funeral in one of their, I don't know who it was a funeral for. I vow to thee, my country. It sounds like church music to me. And because it has become church music, and it's just real simple. Got that D in the bottom. It's real simple, but it's beautiful. It's wonderfully orchestrated. I don't know if you can hear it over the show, dear listener, but when those violins are playing the unison over the orchestra and they go higher and higher, if you ever get to go see an orchestra again in person, I don't know that that'll ever happen, but it shimmers. I don't think you quite get it through headphones, what violins sound like in person. If you could go see this with this full orchestra and stand there or sit there, I'd rather you stand. I think you should stand for this kind of music and hear that just shimmering all around you. It makes your hair move. Mm-hmm. So you can have something just this simple. I'm just going to take this real simple melody and we're just going to get louder and louder. It's going to have those kind of offbeats in the offbeat harmonies, and then I'm just going to hit you with the whole orchestra playing it, and you would have tears in your eyes. It's very English. It reminds me a lot of Elgar's Nimrod.
Yep. Yep.
Another Englishman.
I was going to recommend him.
I believe, Karl, check me if I'm wrong here, but I believe that this melody we just listened to is in the Mixolydian mode. So I mentioned Lydian earlier, which is the raised fourth. Mixolydian has a, I believe, a flatted seventh. But it kind of, when you apply that to a melody, it kind of has a heroic sound to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's real simple. You could sing it after the first time you heard it. Bunch of minor thirds, which are really easy to sing. Gosh, I don't know. It's real nice. I don't know what else to say. That's my highfalutin explanation of this. It's real nice.
It's real nice.
Well, you know, that's enough. One of the things I hope to do with this show is to get people to sign up for online great books. The other thing is to maybe get them to listen to this damn music. And sometimes being too high-minded about it and using words like Dorian or whatever may not help, but you know, it's real nice because it really is. And you're not going to get that from, Trent Reznor or, Pink Floyd, even, sorry. You know, it's a kind of nice that you just can't get without this sort of instrumentation and this orchestration. It's about as nice can be, you know? So go listen to the damn thing.
I think it's, we've said this before, it's such an odd thing, a symphony. You're going to have, I don't know, 40, this is probably 50 or 60 people. There's a choir in Neptune, so you have to have a whole girls choir off stage. It's a huge production. There's a pipe organ, which limits where you can play it. There's two harps. Most orchestras don't have a harp or maybe have one. You know, a harp is $10,000. You know, or the one that you're going to play in an orchestra.
Yeah, 20.
The cheap ones are $3,000.
Yeah.
But this is the consensus of people with good taste who cared about music over the 500 or so years that have led to the invention of the modern orchestra. And you ought to give it a listen and dive into this music because they weren't wrong. Really, it's so good. I mean, on a nice stereo, you need a good stereo to listen to it if you're not going to go in person. You can't use your monotone, your monophonic Bluetooth speaker. I'm sorry. You need better. But even better is to go and listen to it if you can still do that wherever you live. Yeah. I can't hear, but
the bass is so good. When we heard those big chords, those big clashing chords in Mars, there's a whole octave below that, like, really what I would say is the audible spectrum. Obviously you can hear it, but there's a whole octave below that can be felt only. And when you play it on a good system, you can feel that rumbling. It's fantastic. You're never going to get that on a little Bluetooth speaker.
Everything makes me so sad.
Scott is scowling.
Yeah, you know, my assignment was to listen to this and get ready for the show. And we talked about it. We're recording late, I think. Aren't we recording a week late? I can't remember.
Yeah.
So I think we've had 3 weeks to listen to this. We decided to do this show and 3 weeks. So I've got some earbuds I can put on, and then I can cover them up with my hearing protection when I'm on the tractor or running a saw or whatever I'm doing. So I did that. And I've listened to this on my great big Pioneer speakers, you know, the stereo system. And I've actually heard this live too. I had those little piezoelectric shitty speakers in my ear holes, and I covered them up with my decibel defense, you know, hearing protection or whatever. It was terrible. I listened to about 3 minutes of Mars. I'm like, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do it.
Yeah.
There you go. It sucks, man. It sucks.
Yeah. If music is important to you, then finding a decent thing to play it on is important as well. And it's not that expensive anymore. It's not like in the 70s.
Yeah, you don't need a tube amp to power a good pair of speakers. You just need a good pair of speakers and pretty much anything that's not the cheapest, crappiest receiver will do the job. You know, anything that's got a decent enough amount of power, just get yourself a good pair of speakers. If you're patient, you can go to Goodwill and find some for $100, $200. It's all you need.
Yeah.
It's all you need.
Oh, God. Every Star Trek episode ever.
Glockenspiel.
I think part of what makes it so cinematic is the themes are kept pretty much pristine, which means you can attach them to characters very easily. Characters or moods.
Yeah.
Which was the big Star Wars trick, but he didn't invent it. He got it from Holst and Wagner and whoever else did this sort of thing where here's my, you know, this is the Ring theme. This is Photon's theme, you know, or this is Jupiter's theme.
And what kind of music is this?
What kind of music?
Yeah, what is this?
I don't know. It's orchestral music.
Yeah, it's not good enough. Like, we'd have, has a term arisen for this stuff, right? I threw out some names: Mussorgsky, this guy, Stravinsky, Aaron Copland. I don't know. Maybe even Gershwin and American in Paris, right? This sort of cinematic. First half of the 20th century stuff. What is this? Do we know yet? Maybe John Williams goes in there.
Could it be impressionist music?
I think it's very impressionistic. Whatever good that is. You know, me thinking that.
It's modern, but it's not awful.
Well, it is. So there's an interesting thing in the art world that happened between, well, at the tail end of Impressionism and then sort of in that interwar period, a little bit after when this was released. And in Germany in particular, there's this thing called Expressionism that comes up, which is kind of impressionistic, but it gets a lot more absurd and a lot more gross, for lack of a better term. You know, it's just, it's, you know, you take a face and you just distort it until it's just, it's recognizable, but it's, disgusting almost. This is maybe kind of, it's not a diffuse, very broad sort of approach to art. It has a little bit more focus to it that I think eventually gets distorted into something like expressionism. It's not expressionism, but it's something that happens kind of the tail end of impressionism, where it gets a little bit more hard and defined, but it's not yet distorted and subverted yet.
So there's the weirdness in music, the atonality, all. There's bits of that in here. So Schoenberg is in here, except rather than it's like, this is what Holst does. This is a color I can use. These are things I can use to express stuff. They're not the main thing.
He has a purpose for using that.
Yeah.
And his purpose isn't to destroy Schoenberg.
I mean, if you look at I'm trying to figure out the chords. There's a, there's like a D flat in the trumpet against Fs and Cs and in Mars, and there's a bunch of other notes too. So that's modern. Beethoven occasionally does it, but Mozart doesn't do that stuff. So I guess I can really lean into this dissonance, and I can use all 12 notes that I have. Okay, but what are you going to do with them? You know, you have this new tool. You know, I guess thanks to Schoenberg and the atonal music, but you don't have to make it not, you don't have to make it suck.
Right. Yeah. When we get to Neptune, I do want to get to Neptune, because there's some weird stuff with it. I feel like there's not just dissonance. There's also like some weird tuning stuff with the
strings. I kind of wanted to get into Uranus. I'm sorry, that one's really good too. My kids have been giggling over that all week.
Uranus.
I've been telling them, I've been listening to Uranus.
Yeah.
And it just makes my kid giggle every time.
It's only.
Yeah, we only did, we didn't even do, I mean, we could have done the whole planets, but they're all good. I guess I'm the only one that likes Venus.
Oh, okay.
I prefer Saturn.
Mercury is fun, flying around, flitting around. Saturn is very cool. Neptune is weird.
Yeah, can we listen to a little bit of that?
Let's listen to it.
The tuning part that I want to point out happens at about a little after 2 minutes. I think I marked 2:08, but we can listen to the beginning and then maybe skip forward to that 2 minute mark.
Yeah, let's listen to the very beginning and know that in that first 2 or 3 seconds, the conductor is chewing on someone. Here we go.
Can't get movies out of my head listening to this.
I know.
Indiana Jones is finding the Ark. Darn it, John Williams.
Right there. So, that dissonance, it's not just dissonance. It's also, it's almost like they switch temperament. I can't quite tell what's going on there, but those flutes go real flat, it sounds like to me, which I thought was cool. It's almost like he's playing a quarter tone.
Yeah, I heard that.
Happens right at about, I think I marked it like 2 minutes and 8 seconds, somewhere around, it's very close to that point.
Okay, let's hear that again at 2:08. Actually, I want to back it up to 2:06, you know. Yeah. There. It's crazy.
Yeah, then you have that, the strings quietly going up and down these arpeggios.
Imagine the director.
You've heard that a billion times before.
The director yelling, "Susan, you're in tune."
Yeah, it's really interesting. So, like, you know, I can see how a stringed instrument could easily do that, you know, because if you're playing a violin, you don't have frets, so you can make the note as sharp or flat as you want. But if you're a woodwind instrument, it's kind of hard to do that. You can bend the note, you know, you can bend the pitch up and down a little bit, but I'm not quite sure how they're achieving that effect. But somebody sounds like they're going real flat in that little section, and it's definitely intentional.
Yeah, you want to play, normal people want to play in tune. And it's really difficult to nail a pitch like that that's out of tune and just stand on it.
Right, yeah. It doesn't waver out of tune. Yeah, it's perfectly out of tune.
Yeah.
I'm trying to see if that's notated or if that's just a peculiarity of this performance.
Yeah, it was a cool decision. You know, whoever's decision it was, that was a cool little detail there.
Yeah, that's what the conductors tell Susan. Listen, you know, up there in measure 52, you're going to have to stand on that, and you're going to be flat. Do not bend. If you bend that up, we're done. We're done.
So the YouTube algorithm a while back was throwing me all these videos of Leonard Bernstein in rehearsal, and I don't even know what piece they were working on, but there's like this series of he gets in arguments with different members of the band.
Is he awful?
Entertaining. No, he was actually he's quite polite. There was an upstart trumpet player who got snarky with him, and he resolved the situation fairly.
I have mixed feelings on Leonard.
Me too.
Yeah.
He was a big part of 20th century music, and I've played a bunch of his stuff. And I listen to it now, and I'm not sure it's that good.
It's not.
I liked his Jeremiah Symphony. I thought that was pretty good. But he did some weird things. Like, he did a recording of West Side Story with opera singers. And, you know, back when I was a kid, I thought that I should like it because it's Leonard Bernstein, and I think it's awful. He has Kiri Takanawa and Jose Carreras. And he picked Jose Carreras to play Tony. Tony is the Polish guy. Mm-hmm. In West Side Story. And so you have Jose Carrera saying, could be, who knows, and sounding as Spanish as he can. And plus, Jose doesn't have rhythm. So he can't, could it be? There's some weird rhythms in West Side Story, and there's exists tapes of the rehearsals, and he just could not get it. You want me to sing off the beat? There's just no way. I don't know why Lenny picked that. It was a real clam.
There was, in one of those videos, I remember now, there was a moment where he's playing through, he's got a singer there, and she's like, whoa, stop. She's like, this is way too fast. I can't get all the words out. Like, you got to slow it down. He's just like, nobody can hear you anyway. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, somebody has to make those decisions. Sometimes that's right. Dismissive, and he's wrong, but not always.
Nope.
Not everything matters not everything has equal importance. Somebody has to make those calls, and that's his job, you know?
Well, he was big for popularization of this kind of music, and he would do radio shows, introductions to the orchestra, and just, you know, teach people about the music. So that's not inconsiderable. It's not always the greatest music from him.
One of my many gigs that I do is I mix music, and when you're mixing, you're trying to make the whole picture work. I mean, you're kind of like a conductor with modern music. You know, you're bringing up how much bass do we need? How much drums? You know, should they be far away? Should they be up close? Blah, blah, blah. And one of the things that, if you've ever been in a band and you've tried, like the poor mixer has been there with the band in attendance, the bass player is like, hey man, can you turn up the bass a little bit? I'd like to hear a little bit more bass. And the guitar player is like, yeah, can I have some more guitars? And the drums are like, I don't know, it sounds like the drums, I can't really hear them now because the bass and guitars got turned up. Can you turn those up too? And the singer's like, well, you can't hear the lyrics now. So
shove them all up.
Everybody's just turning everything up the whole time. It's a nightmare.
So the trick is you turn the bass up in the bass guy's monitor.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so yeah, exactly. More me.
Right.
But... there's one other cool little tidbit like we just listened to in Neptune in Saturn that I thought would be cool to look at. It's right at 7 minutes, kind of between 7 and 8 minutes in Saturn. Saturn is a fairly slow piece like Venus. It's very subtle. But there's some cool kind of looping sort of sound that happens at 7 minutes. But it's not looping because they're playing it live, but it sounds like a loop, and I thought it was just a really cool modern thing to do.
Saturn, the bringer of old age.
Yeah.
Is that a celeste?
It may be.
So.
Maybe a harp. Circular melody just kind of loops around and around and around.
Bass.
So I thought the flutes in particular in this passage were really interesting because sometime in the, 60s, I think, there is this movement called musique concrète. Some French guys basically started making the first ambient music. And one of the big things that they did was they would take tape loops, right? So, you know, there were machines that were developed, you know, after the tape recorder had been out for a couple decades. There were machines developed to basically loop a tape over and over. So you record a piece of music on a piece of tape and you basically tape it to itself so it becomes a circle and you can just keep playing it over and over and over. And if you cut it just right, when you reach the end of the piece, the beginning of the piece sort of fits. So there's no like weird hiccup or gap. And if you just kind of have these things going over and over, you have a loop and it just creates this pretty little sort of shimmering, you know, cloud of music that you can play a melody over or sing over or whatever.
Sell shoes at a department store too.
Yeah, sure. This actually reminded me though of, this band in the shoegaze genre, which is a an offshoot of that whole ambient thing that started in the 60s, My Bloody Valentine. But yeah, and you've heard it many places, right? It's just that sort of flute motif. But I thought it was an interesting choice because really we don't hear that a lot in classical music where you have a melodic theme that's just circular like that, that just keeps getting repeated. Usually it evolves or it goes somewhere.
Do you have a little My Bloody Valentine that we could hit for an example?
Yeah, the song To Hear Knows When. You'll hear it. They used a lot of loops at the beginning of the song.
God help us.
Sounds like the air conditioner has a problem.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Yeah. So there you go. There's a little shoegaze. That's probably the seminal shoegaze album. But yeah, there's you go. There's those loops. And you've heard them in, you know, if you pull up YouTube, like yoga music, you'll hear it there too.
This is new to me. Shoegaze. S-H-O-E-G-A-Z-E.
Yeah. You've never heard of shoegaze?
No.
Really? Interesting. No. Yeah, it was a movement. It was part of the alt rock movement of the early 90s.
You hear what he just
laid in such hipster.
You hear what he did
to
me.
You've never heard of shoegaze?
Shoegaze is a big deal. Like we're already on like generation two of shoegaze. Like it's hip with the kids.
Oh, listen.
Wait, is shoegaze a band or a genre?
No, it's a genre. It's a genre. And the seminal album is My Bloody Valentine's Loveless.
I moved on.
Is the name of the album
to Naval Gaze from this shoegaze.
No, it's like basically if you took like new wave, but you made it
worse.
Like you took the, you add a lot of fuzz to it, and you make it more ambient.
Recorded on a Fisher Price tape recorder. Holy shit, Tramp!
Yeah,
what have
so
you done to me?
That album was unique. I'll leave it at that.
Have you paid money for that?
Yes.
Oh my Lord!
I bought it used though. So I bought it for $5.
Good.
Bucks.
You didn't help them out. So.
No, I think it's a great album. It's really cool. But they intentionally made it sound very weird.
It's no Violator.
There's a whole bunch of weird stuff.
It is no Violator, for sure.
Well, if we're picking out little cool bits, can you play the beginning of Uranus?
I'd love to pick...
Just for some fun brass writing. So we're talking about modern music. I mean, that's it. You know, those are not notes that go together. That's G, E flat, A, B. All right, so it's kind of atonal. It's modern, but it doesn't suck. You know, it's, in other words, what I mean is it's still melodic.
Yeah.
There's still a point to the music. It's not, let me do weird things.
We can spice our food. We just don't have to eat nothing but peppers.
Right.
If the salt loses its savor, Karl.
Just throw it out. I remember, I have fond memories of drum corps when I was young in the 80s. And the Rosemont Cavaliers played a Planets show. It was very neat. And this was one of their big ones, was Uranus. I still can't say that without giggling, though. My kids are like, why are they calling it Uranus now? Well, because of people like me.
Right. Yeah, the shoot's ruining everything for us.
Dear listener, if you've never listened to this, you probably have. But if you've never listened to it, just go, spend an hour, listen to it. It's really good. It's really evocative. It's got a low entry. You don't have to know anything. You know, if I had any thoughts on this show, I mean, it's the same thing that Scott has. I was thinking about this. I have done music since I was 5 years old. So that's 45 years I have been doing music in some form or other. Sometimes I get paid for it, but I've been doing it for a long, long time. But I haven't gone to school and studied classical forms. You know, I don't know all this stuff. All the music theory I got, I picked up on the streets. You know?
School of hard knocks.
Right. I didn't get to go to music school. Probably would have ruined me.
Yeah.
So you, dear listener, who might not have gone to music school either. You know, it's like films. There's film school films,
ugh,
which are films made for film school people, and they suck. They're terrible.
Yeah.
They're no good. Well, you can do that with music, and you can just do music that is odd and strange and interesting, and you're composing for other composers. So that they'll say, well, that was it. Wow, you did something strange there. Ah, you know, it's like,
interesting choice.
So where I'm going to go with Gustav Holst on his socialism, music is for everybody. Not everybody's going to be able to ascend to the heights and figure out, you know, all the things that are going on, but everybody can listen to this, and you don't know how high you can go. And the thing is, every step you go higher, there's more beauty revealed to you.
I think that's right. You know, sometimes I think maybe we should have started the whole darn show with something like this, or Gershwin, and then just went up the accessibility scale, you know?
Well, we would have had to have had a plan.
Right. Who wants that? Yeah, that's no fun. But this stuff is super, super accessible, and people should go listen to Holst. And we've thrown out another number of other names as well. And you'll find that you already knew this stuff. That's one of the interesting things about it is when I hear something and it's like it was always there for me.
Yeah. Deja vu.
Yeah. It turns me into Plotinus. I wonder, you know, I hear it in pop music. I don't know, you know, some Katy Perry song in the hook. When it's time for the hook to show up, I already know what it's going to be. Now, and this is a brand new song I've never heard before, is that because it's derivative and predictable, or is it because that's the proper hook and that's where it's supposed to go, and I recognize it when the time comes?
Oh, I had a strange experience the other day. I was listening to another podcast that... It was one of those podcasts that decent people probably shouldn't listen to.
Rogan.
No. But he has musical interludes, and they're always interesting. And, you know, he used to play lots of Scriabin, but now he's playing weird stuff. And
yeah, Scriabin's not weird.
No, it needs to be weirder than that. And I had this strange experience that it was like time had stopped, or I had gone outside of time. I know this is going to sound really weird, but I knew what notes were going to come next, and I'd never heard this thing before in my life. And I felt like I was transcending the moment. And if you think about it, what you have to do to listen to music, music comes at you in time. You have to be able to stretch from the past and have some anticipation into the future. You can't just be a point in time and listen to music. Maybe that's why some people can't enjoy it. Mm-hmm. You have to be able to stretch and have a memory of what's gone behind and anticipate what's going on in the future. And I was really having that experience right there. And I had to stop the podcast. What's going on? You know, what means? Like the gods were speaking to me. It was very strange.
Yeah. So where does that music reside? I mean, this is...
Yeah. I've said it before. A number of great writers of music and other forms of literature and art have described the process of writing as it's like you're poking around for, you know, when you are writing, you're kind of poking around looking for threads, and eventually, and sometimes you stumble across a thread and you start pulling, and it's like the story is already there. It's like the song is already there. Your craftsmanship as a writer is really just not to fumble it when you when you pull the thread. Don't break it off.
Often,
but if you're skillful, you can pull it out. But it's already there. It's like it just writes itself.
Yeah. Often art is discovery, not invention.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just find a block of stone and chip everything away that's not David, you know, or whatever. It's already there. Yeah. And so when I hear this music, that is obvious to me. And then, and then we do these seminars where we talk about Plato and we talk about justice or whatever. And I think that when we're at our best, we have that same notion of some of these ideals like justice or virtue or whatever, as we do about, you know, good melody and where the bridge is going.
I think so. I think music forces you to grapple with the fact that as humans, we are not just logical creatures. We have...
That's not what the Austrians say. They say that we're rational and we always vote with our dollars in our own best interest, and that pricing contains all information.
Well, that's not what I say. Oh. I'm not Austrian either.
I'm not going to act rationally just out of spite.
There you go.
There you go. Yeah. But yeah, we have a very strong sense of intuition that goes hand in hand with the logos.
Yeah, I mean there was a medieval notion of the scholastic notion of connaturality. You share the same sort of nature as the things around you. The Austrian school, this modern notion of, you know, I can be whatever I want. I can, if I just think I'm something, I am that thing.
Oh, wait a minute. That's not Austrian. Those are the nominalists, who I also hate.
I think they're kissing cousins.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. Okay. Nominalism leads to the idea that you can just, everything is a result of reason. It's an imposition of reason upon the world and not a discovery of things in the world.
Well, I think that the tune in for the whole get this instead. I think those nominalists are like a cargo cult. They're like, I'm going to call the United States Army an army, and even though they wear high heels and they don't know how to break shit and win, we've got an army. Because that they wear the army costumes and they have the army name. Just made some folks mad.
Yeah.
Like if they have a budget and they have the right costumes, then it's a school. Nobody learns anything.
Right. So yeah, it's the power of the naming. That's where I connect the nominalists and the rationalists.
Yeah. And then the rationalists, you know, I was talking to my uncle about this. He was talking about smoking and he was actually talking about legalization of pot. And he said, you know, when's everything going to turn against pot? You know, it used to be 7 out of 10 doctors recommend Lucky Strikes, you know, it used to be that. And so when is weed going to not be like an organic healthy choice and turn, you know, and culture turned south on it, you know?
Yeah.
And he's like, doesn't everybody know that it can't be good for you? And then I said, well, you know, Socrates tells us that everybody acts in the, you know, in pursuit of what they think is the good. They just have incomplete information or the wrong notion of it. And so those Austrians didn't read their Plato. They don't realize that, oh, well, maybe people, maybe they do act according to the rationality, but they don't have complete information and they don't have proper notions of the good. And the wheels fell off.
They also didn't read their Dostoevsky.
Sometimes
you're just going to act out of spite.
Yeah. Yeah. People throw bricks.
You can do me right and I'll do you wrong.
Right. Yeah. People throw bricks sometimes.
Yeah.
Screw you, Dad.
Well, we like war.
Like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I like to listen to the music that before Austrian economics. but von Mises says, blech. Ugh. Ugh. All right. Any more Holst guys?
Well, I mean, it's been infinity hours already.
Right.
There's some cool stuff in Venus, but you guys didn't want to do it, so it's fine. It's a song that's in 2 meters, but it would take a while to look at it. I love Mercury. I love the swelling of the strings in Mercury.
I love the swelling in Uranus.
There's some there too.
So dumb.
So there's this place in Missouri. If you take the highway through Missouri, which is what you do in Missouri, you take the highway through Missouri, and there's a place called Uranus. Mm-hmm. And there's signs for Uranus, you know, miles and miles ahead, like 100 miles ahead. Get the best fudge in Uranus. Have good times in Uranus. It's the one joke. You know, if you go there and buy fudge, they say, would you like your fudge firmly packed in Uranus?
Oh, my God.
It's the same joke. And so I was saying to my daughter, Elizabeth, as we were driving through one time, I said, I want to buy this place next door, and I'm going to name it Your Butt.
Taint.
They're going to say, get the finest fudge in your butt. We're just going to take Uranus's cheap joke and just make it even more obvious and steal all their customers.
No.
That's expressionism, right? That would be the where you just actually have...
Well, you know, it's kind of clever, but you stop there and you're they're too far. This is who's that comedian that'll take the joke and just do it over and over?
Norm MacDonald.
Oh, may he rest in peace. I was thinking of Will Ferrell.
Yeah, Will Ferrell. Yeah. You know, some more modern stuff. Will Ferrell isn't actually funny. He creates discomfort. And then people start making that weird nervous laugh, and he just cranks the discomfort up. But it's not comedy. I mean, sometimes he does comedy, but most of the time it's just squirmy shit.
Yeah. So cringe.
Cringe. Yeah.
Yeah.
So is that the same as The Office, you know, Steve Carell? Is that funny or is it just cringe?
Can I tell you a secret?
Yes.
I never watched The Office.
No, me neither. I've seen clips of it. Yeah.
Yeah. It has value only in being in a excellent microcosm of the pathology of corporate organizations.
Yeah, but do we need that though? Like you go sit there for 45 hours a week and then, you know, and then you gotta go watch that. I've seen clips from that show that were genuinely funny, but most of it is about, you know, creating this discomfort and then, you know, claiming that it's comedy and it's not. Maybe it's worth doing, but it's not funny.
You know, I lament the loss of, I think this might be the rarest form of comedian, of the one-liner.
Like Rickles or Henny Youngman or.
Yeah. I was thinking the last great one was, I'm trying to think of his name. You know, he did the CD jokes. Mitch Hedberg. Yeah, he had great punchlines, but he also had some great one-liners. And you know, that's like how every writer starts out wanting to be a poet, and they realize they can't do it because nobody can do poetry except for like, you know, one out of a billion people. And so they suck at that. So they're like, oh, well, I'll just write short stories, because that's like, you know, writers write short stories. And they realize that nobody can do that either. That's like one out of a million. And so they write novels instead.
Yeah, so you get Larry McMurtry.
You get away with a lot. Yeah, so that's kind of the same thing with comedy, I think. It's like, you know, everybody probably wants to be a one-liner comic, but just can't do it.
Yes.
So rare.
Yeah, Stephen Wright will just stand there and just deadpan weird sentences at you, and they're hilarious. It's tough. Rickles, holy crap. Guy's so
Don
fast.
Rickles is,
yeah.
When he was on The Tonight Show, that was the best television.
Killer.
I know that's a million years ago.
Karl, I was thinking about Lonesome Dove the other day.
Yes.
Karl and Brett McKay and I discussed that on the Online Great Books podcast, I don't know, at the beginning of the summer. And I wasn't sure what I thought about it at the time. I wasn't in love with it, but I wasn't sure what I thought about it. And as time goes on, I'm souring on it more and more and more. It's just a thoroughly modern book. It's just some more of that critique, you know? It's gross. I'm unhappy about having read it now. Thanks, McKay. That's the only time he's ever done me wrong.
I thought that'd be your reaction, actually. It just took a while for that shoe to drop.
Yeah. Gosh. I mean,
the best part's the friendship.
He's probably capable of writing a great book, but he's a boomer and he can't do it. He can't get there.
Well, the thing is, yeah, the problem is, I think the big problem is you have to believe something. I think in art, you have to have a story you're trying to tell, and it needs to be coherent. It doesn't necessarily have to be true.
What if he has a story he wants to tell, which is that people are gross?
It's not a good story.
I know.
That's just nature. I mean, that's not even nature. That's subnature.
Yeah, and I think he has a dim view of people. And even if he doesn't have a dim view of people that informed the characters, he has a dim view of what people want or what they deserve in their art. And I don't appreciate it.
Well, so I want to go back to Holst here. So this whole thing's about astrology, and I don't think much of astrology, but it's wonderful.
Well, that's the thing about music, though. You know, he doesn't get to say this is about, I mean, he can tell people in interviews, but the piece itself doesn't say, hey, I'm about astrology. So, you know, again, I'll be platonic. He can think whatever the hell he wants when he's writing the thing. But the truth of it is when it's turned loose into the wild, it becomes what it really is. And he can say it's about astrology, but then we listen to it and know that it's about something that's actually true and real and perfect.
Yeah. I remember Socrates always complaining about, he would go and talk to the writers and the poets, try to get an idea of, you know, beauty.
Oh, yeah.
And
they were worse
good
than anybody.
He,
so he would go.
Yeah.
He talked to politicians and craftsmen and writers, and the writers were the worst. Anybody in the audience could interpret their poem better than they could.
Right.
I remember you were talking about Sopranos earlier. Who was the director of that thing?
David Chase.
Yeah. So
he didn't direct them all. Nerds are yelling. He's the creator of and.
All right. Fine. But the beginning sequence was pretty cool. So you have Tony in the car driving from New Jersey driving from the city out to New Jersey. And to me, it's very clear what's going on. I mean, this is a story about a guy who's in the mob and is trying to get out and be respectable and have his nice garden house in New Jersey. You know, it's like the intro is the whole theme to me. And I listened to David Chase talk. Yeah, so this is just a story about him. This is just him driving.
Right.
What? You don't... So he was able to recognize that he'd done something great and put it on film. He didn't know why. It's like, well, this is the right thing. But I, stupid me in the audience, I can figure out why it's good and he doesn't know.
Yeah. Artists are intuits, you know, that's...
Like Eskimos?
You know. No, like the tax software.
Oh. Yeah. I thought you said...
Yeah. TurboTax. Yeah. Yeah. I would be interested in... I don't know if... you already have a infinity squared pile over there, but I would be interested sometime in talking about T.H. White with y'all.
Yeah, we'll do that
Jordan
someday.
Picked up... I've got a little collection of T.H. White novels. And he's famous for writing The Once and Future King. But yeah, he strikes me as like kind of Tolkien-esque in the sense that he was much more, I think, of the time in his perspective. You know, he was very much like wrapped up in the whole post-war shit that was going on, post-World War II stuff. But he also wrote with a certain tenderness towards his characters that I believe that guy thought that people were all right at the end of the day, even though... they do some very terrible things.
I've read Once and Future King 10 times.
Yeah, The Sword and the Stone, the first piece of it that he wrote as a standalone, kind of like The Hobbit, is just fantastic.
My daughter
so
only
good.
Reads the first part, and then she stops.
Yeah.
She doesn't want to read about Guinevere.
Yeah. And that's valid, and that very well may be the book to talk about, is just The Sword and the Stone.
Well, no. Has there ever been a more wide-ranging podcast than this one?
Well, it is music and ideas.
That's true.
Yeah, because none of this stuff is a silo, by the way. You know, the New York Times, you know, music critic, whatever, the lick spittle who writes for Rolling Stones is going to talk about the album. But it's not a silo. You know, Gustav Holst, The Planets, it's not a standalone thing. You know, when we listen to it, we bring ourselves to it. It's from a certain time. It's by a human being. It's ultimately about human beings. Even if it's about nature or the planets, I still think it's about human beings. I think these things are evocative of ideals, and they ought to be. But, you know, if you're a music critic for Rolling Stone, you don't have any ideas. So, you know, they talk about production values and compare shit to Dylan and whatever. It's fine. That's why nobody reads that thing.
Legitimately, some of the worst writing you'll ever read is music critique.
Yeah, it's terrible.
It's.
I got a couple ideas for upcoming shows, unless somebody else does.
Well, I think you're next, sir.
Well, we don't have to go in order. If somebody's got something to just burn in their pocket.
No, I have to have order somewhere in my life. No,
just somewhere.
The cycle must continue.
Well, just call me in the morning. I'll tell you what to do each day. It'll be fine.
Oh, okay. All right.
But if it is my turn, I've got two you guys can pick from. Oscar Peterson's at the Stratford Shakespearean Festival live album, 1956, little jazz, or a little Debussy, Prelude to the Afternoon of the Faun. Y'all pick.
Well, they're both highbrow.
They're both highbrow. Yeah, Oscar Peterson's highbrow.
Is he? He's just perfect.
I love Debussy. Debussy is so good.
Well, after Uranus.
Can't get enough. Debussy.
I would go with Mr. Claude myself, but I don't know the other one at all.
Uh-oh. Do you know the Oscar Peterson album, Carl?
I have listened to Oscar Peterson. I'm not sure I've listened to that one.
Well, why don't I just make my next two? Why don't I just announce them now? We'll do Peterson this time and then do the Debussy piece here in, you know, four shows or whatever it is when it falls on me next.
Magnifique.
Yeah, Oscar Peterson Trio, that's his best ensemble, I think. It's oh my gosh, I'm going to have to look it up. Ray Brown and Herb Ellis. Herb Ellis, killer guitar player. I mean, it's just pared down. It's just three dudes just killing it. Killing it! And I don't even like piano much.
What's wrong with you?
All right.
It's a music calculator. You push the buttons and the values come out. And you can push the buttons skillfully or less skillfully and whatever. But, you know, you can't bend the pitch. You know, you don't put your mouth on it. I don't know, man.
Well, you need a melodica.
that ocarina that. He's talking about. All right. There's another Music and Ideas podcast. I think we all had hell with this one in these trying times. I think it's kind of tough to
It's hard to enjoy music these days, but it's one of the few things that does bring me pleasure.
Yeah.
So that's good.
How about you, Karl? Was this was this easy peasy for you?
No, I was cramming. I many things on my mind right now, and being rational for podcast is tricky.
We need to just make a comedy podcast where we don't have to be rational or nice or thoughtful or anything.
Then I'd have to be funny.
Yeah, it's pretty hard. That's why I never am. All right, there's the Music and Ideas podcast. Please, this one seems to be growing. You know, Trent took a little screenshot of the download graph. Maybe there were numbers on there, but I just looked at the shape of the graph, and it's going up and to the right, so that's good. But it's not as high on the end up to the right as it ought to be. So please recommend this show to one other friend. You know, if there's anybody that's a movie buff, which is every, you know, normie that you work with, tell them, oh, you like John Williams? Maybe you should listen to this show about Holst. Or you know, somebody that hates country music, send them the Bob Wills show or something, right? Recommend one of our shows to somebody you know, not just out of the blue, but, you know, kind of think about it. You know, think about it, which show would fit which person and recommend it. That would be a big help to us because, you know, Spotify didn't pay us $100 million for our back catalog, so they don't promote it because apparently our show is not as good as Rogan's show is. Right? Because prices contain all information about the value of a good or service in the marketplace. So he got $100 million and we have $3, so his show's more valuable than ours.
We got $3?
No, probably not. I'm rounding up from zero.
Yeah, Spotify does not pay. You know, so if I have some music on Spotify, and you know, so I make 0.001 cents every time somebody streams that or whatever. But Spotify doesn't pay anything for.
Well,
podcasts.
You should give us a link so we can just
big fat zero.
Just give us a link so we can put it on loop while you sleep.
Yeah, that has been done. Yeah, people have written programs to do that. Yeah, they just like they'll have like 10-second songs.
Yeah, Wolfbeck did a whole album of silent music.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. Yep.
And had their fans stream it so that they could fund their tour.
Where would somebody find this music, Trent? I mean,
do you have a stage name?
Well, you can go. Yeah. So my Instagram handle is Marmalade Cream, and that's my artist name on Spotify as well. I just have a few tracks on there. It's really just kind of fun stuff that I made for the hell of it. I've got a few instrumental guitar tracks and then
is this your gym jams?
That was the original idea. Yeah, I would write rock songs to lift to, and they're still good for that.
Yeah,
but I just put them up on Spotify if you want to give them a listen.
Yeah, so that's something you could do when you're out at the gym and request they put it on that and just loop that. And gym jams,
yeah.
And you know, maybe Trent will make enough this year to buy some toothpaste or something, you know.
Yeah, well, you know, if I can buy a cup of coffee, then maybe I'll make another one.
There you go. Oh gosh, but you know, if you do what you love, you never work a day in your life. You'll go broke, you'll starve to death, but you'll never work a day in your life.
It's a labor of love.
Yeah. All right, there's that show. Pass it on, please, please, please. Also, leave us a review wherever you listen to your shows. That's also a big help. And, you know, go check out the Online Great Books podcast. The first 30 seconds is great of each of those shows because it's Holst. So, you know, stick around and see if the next hour is okay there too. Thank you guys so much for listening. We'll talk to you in a couple weeks.